Uh-oh.
All right, fellas. We have some very distinguished palates here today. I like to call them our super judges. Fred Minnick.
Gentlemen.
And we have Tim Jones. And I hope y'all know who I am.
Sadly, yes.
Mark Ramsey.
Tell us about the wood that you all use in the aging process.
I have a medium toast oak and a very, very light toast oak. I'm keeping it about as simple, stupid as you can get it. There's a really fine line. If you ain't careful, you get too much oak taste.
Just a pinch over just enough is too much.
Looks like Tim's got a lot more variety of jars over there.
Well, mine's a little different. I've got some plain toast, American white. I've got some French toast. I also got some apple sticks.
Have you ever used that combination before? Is this brand new?
No, this is brand new to me now. You only got a few hours to make this thing change color, change flavor profile. Not too worried about the color, but I was very worried about the taste profile because you could destroy this thing.
Digger, what you got going on over there?
I got some good oak. Trying not to over oak it, but just to get cinnamon, nutmeg, and vanilla in there, hopefully.
Okay.
And I'm gonna hope that I make a fine jar of liquor.
We's down to 15 minutes.
I got beautiful mahogany color, and Tim Smith's still over making a milkshake.
You've got a great color going on right now.
It'll be mahogany in the morning.
Tim Smith over there, that's a nice color too.
I'm done.
Bringing it in here, boss.
All right. I have to admit, that's one fine-looking jar of liquor. Yeah. It's got a beautiful color to it.
A little bit of apple, a little bit of French oak.
I'll go along with that.
Sure.
One rapid aging jar of liquor.
I'll see y'all fellas in the morning.
What you got to do. I'm going home and take a shower.
Well, they leave me here long enough. I'm drinking some of this.
Let's try this stuff.
It probably wouldn't hurt to take a sip out of each one of them. All right, fellas. You're gonna have 15 minutes to strain, filter, and blend that one jar as much as you can.
I'm really ready for it.
Yeah, I'm excited. I'm really excited to taste that.
15 minutes, start now.
So I'm noticing like they all have very different filtering techniques here. So we're gonna see the distillate and some of the aging that came through is gonna shine where others are, you know, wanting to filter it out a little bit. Mm. Tim's using a t-shirt. I mean, I hope he at least cleaned it before he...
He's gotta use his t-shirts for something. He doesn't wear them.
Yeah. This is true.
Tim, why are you using a t-shirt?
Back in my growing up days, we had to use what we had. And if you had something you need to strain it out and you had a piece of clothing on you, you pulled it off and you used that to strain it.
Thank you for not using underwear today. I appreciate that.
That's for date night. That's what that is.
So I'm curious, did everybody have the same recipe?
I put us together a prohibition type liquor. It's about 55 to 57% rye malt extract.
All extract whiskey.
It's a cask strength whiskey. It's about 125.
Well, that's what Tim brushes his teeth with, is cask strength whiskey, so.
I ain't scared of it. So, Mark, is this the first time you've ran extract?
Tim, this is my very first run of extract. I used a rye extract, then I added a Pilsner rye.
Okay.
Rye, you know, it's a finicky mistress, but you work with what you got, do the best you can with it, and move forward.
I think there is a little bit of an upper hand with extracts because it's pretty dialed in. But the nice thing about using grain is that you can experiment and do your own thing.
Tim was using grains.
There's 100% rye in my mash bill. Only thing that I added to my recipes is I did add some apples to my thumper, so the rye came through that.
So we got an apple rye with grain and two different extract builds.
We have some bizarre rye coming our way.
Yeah.
This is where the rubber hits the road, ain't it?
I can't say a hell of a lot about this, but it sure is attractive.
First jar we have up here is Digger.
Well, first nose ain't a treat. Smells more beery to me. There's a funk to this.
This was an experiment. I'd never run any damn extract before.
It tastes a whole lot better than it smells.
Yeah.
It smells like I don't want to put it anywhere near my lips. Once I taste it, I'm getting some honey notes, like some maple syrup, a little rye toast.
You nailed it dead on the head right there.
Even going back to it, I think it gets a little better. But I think the finish is really great, too. The high proof, the rye helps cut through the aging process.
So here is Tim Smith.
I am very confident.
Well, it don't show. I mean,
Red.
You haven't tasted it yet.
The nose is light years, so much better than.
Yeah, we're talking, this is real rye.
Oh, yeah. I actually get a touch of the apple on it.
This nose is gorgeous.
It is.
I'm intimidated by a lot of things. Tim Smith ain't one of them.
I almost feel like Tim is really on to something.
This is complex.
It is. There's some really, really nice notes that are still standing strong against the wood.
This has chestnuts roasting on an open fire. It's got ginger cookies. It's got cardamom. It's got cinnamon. Every memory of my holidays growing up, sitting around a fire with my family.
I think if you can somehow put nostalgia in a bottle, you've got something.
It's smart to go with what you know. And Tim did what he knew.
Mark Ramsey.
Hey, I only got 4 jars.
Uh-oh. Uh-oh.
You know, it
smells great.
It gives me new respect for the pressure that the contestants are under by being on that side of the table myself.
He really played it down.
He did.
He did. And I think
there's humbleness in this jar.
My goodness. Uh-oh, watch out, Tim.
On the nose, Fred, I don't get the complexity as Tim's, but
there's one note in here that sticks out in a big, big way, and that's cherries.
It's good. It's got a drier note to me.
I don't know, Fred. I like the finish on it.
Mm-hmm.
He's got almost like a raw dough. It's not a cookie dough, but it's like a bread dough. And that can be a very enticing flavor if you're in the mood for it. On the other side, there's just a touch of spice.
I mean, I don't know where you guys sit, but I think,
yeah,
there's no doubt on it.
All right, fellas. I'd love to say this was an easy decision, but it was not.
Digger, when I first smelled it, I didn't want to drink it. The nose was
it's harsh.
Little peculiar to me. Pretty sure that was the extract. But then I tasted it, and it did a 180. The palate was so much better. I think that's probably a little bit of that rapid aging, but your jar was absolute a master of his craft in distilling. No flaws in it.
Digger, on the nose, I'm not as harsh on it. There was just a little bit of funk on it, but on the palate, it is really good.
Mark, drinking yours, I was not thinking I was drinking a whiskey. I was thinking I was drinking a beer stout. And so when this is all over, I'm gonna go get a beer.
Okay.
So, much like Digger, you're to be commended for creating something that is very, very drinkable because people are not out there distilling extract.
Right.
And you made something here that could be put on the shelf.
Thank you, Fred. But I felt like the balance of what you were doing with your distillate and the extract and the aging, there was a much better balance on the palate. It was really well done.
Tim, you bragged that thing up so much that you almost planted a seed in us for us to not like it. You know, as my mama told me growing up, nobody likes a bragger. But when I tasted that, it reminded me of something else from my mama, and that was her cookies when I was growing up. So your technique in using the various pieces of wood compensated for the 100% rye, brought some balance to it.
You know, I thought the complexity on that, as soon as we went to the nose, there was a lot of surprise and delight in there. The rye notes, the apple, balancing that out was really impressive.
It's hard to make rye smooth.
It is, and I think the assortment of wood chips really played in your favor.
But that was a first for me.
It was.
That was
and
a
I
first.
Think you rolled the dice.
I have to say, it was a little bit of luck in that one.
But we taste a lot of the same things. And over time, you get a little bored. And I think what you guys did for us today was challenge it, made it interesting. We had to pick it apart a little differently than we normally do. And all three of you are masters. We know that. There has to be one winner.
Yeah.
But I think all three of you brought really great jars to us.
Thank you, Tim.
Thank you, gentlemen.
They were all winners. And that made this hard to judge.
But I feel like we have one jar that stood out to me as something that I'm buying tomorrow if it's on the shelf.
Yep.
Tim Smith, that's your winning jar right there.